Hi everyone, thank you so much for attending our webinar this afternoon. This presentation is being brought to you by the Society of California Archivists Education Committee. My name is Christine Kim and my co-hosts are Mallory Fernier and Adrian Story. Thank you for joining us for our ongoing series of web-based webinars, workshops, and training sessions offered through SCA. Today's session will be focusing on Beyond Diversity Initiatives, Recruitment of BIPOC into Archives and Special Collections Librarianship. I'd like to introduce our presenters. Azalea Camacho is the Archivist and Special Collections Librarian at the University Library of California State University, Los Angeles. She oversees the operations of the Special Collections and Archives Unit in the library, which includes archival processing and maintenance, including accessioning, processing, and cataloging, supervision of staff, students, and volunteers, coordinating the instruction program and public services, and managing the library's exhibits program. Over the past 6 years at Cal State LA, she has worked to strengthen community partnerships and foster student curiosity in the field by providing engaging opportunities for the campus community. Through her work, she strives to preserve and make accessible the diverse lives reflected in the heavily diverse student population of Cal State LA and the BIPOC communities in the greater Los Angeles area. Amalia Castaneda is the resident archivist at Cal State Dominguez Hills and serves on the board of directors at the Museum of Social Justice. At CSU Dominguez Hills, she teaches information literacy courses and coordinates a diversity initiative of the Library Dean's Office, the Library Careers Training Program for students. Her research interests include racial and ethnic diversity in special collections librarianship and the relationship between urban renewal and historical preservation in progressive era Los Angeles. She holds a bachelor's degree and an MLIS from UCLA and a master's degree in history from Cal State Los Angeles. Karina Cardenas is the Special Collections and Archives Assistant at CSU Fresno. She is the first point of access for reference requests and research appointments. She is a member of the Library Diversity Committee and is interested in student engagement, diversity, equity, and inclusion in the archival field. She also assists with class collaborations and curating exhibitions. She is pursuing an MLIS from San Jose State and holds a master's in history from Cal State LA. Before we get started, we have a few housekeeping points. During the presentation, we are going to mute your lines. If you have questions along the way, please send them through the questions box to all participants. We'll collect these for a Q&A session with the presenters at the end of the presentation. We will be recording today's session and we'll be circulating a link to all of you after today. So let's get started.
There we go. Okay, next slide. Okay, so good morning, everyone, and thank you for being here with us today. So the driving question of this presentation and this research is, despite many of the diversity programs and initiatives that we see and that we're aware of, why has the number of Black, Indigenous, and people of color in academic librarianship continued to remain stagnant for decades? Next slide. Perhaps one of the first assumptions is that there aren't enough BIPOC obtaining college degrees yet. But according to the National Center for Education Statistics, the number of bachelor's degrees awarded to Latino students more than tripled between 2001 and 2016. During that same period, the number of degrees awarded to also increased for Asians who were Asian Pacific Islander by 75% and Black by 75%. So without even looking at the numbers and stats, just anecdotally, many of us can probably attest to these rapid demographic changes. So the students are there, they're in our institutions. So why are these changes not significantly reflected in our profession? So let's put all this into context, right? So this that you see here is a really, really brief sort of mapping of the history of initiatives in ALA, SAA, RBMS history, And as we well know, conversations around racial and ethnic diversity are now in the forefront of our profession, but they're technically not new. You know, as a matter of fact, they go back to the 1920s when ALA created the Board of Education for Librarianship that was intended at education and training for Black librarians. And then in the 70s, we saw many of the ALA ethnic caucuses that we're very familiar with. In the 1980s, ALA drafted its first diversity policy. But it was really the result of the 1997 RBMS survey that began to actively push the special collections and archives world to take a closer look at the racial and ethnic demographics. And the survey revealed that 96% of its members were white. Next slide. So based on data from the 1997 survey, only 1% of librarians were Latino, 1% Black, with 0% Asian American, and 0% Indigenous Native American. And these results we see here, in this slide here, are the results of the RBMS 2015 survey. And they reveal some progress, but very modest progress at that. So think about these numbers in the context of current bachelor's and master's degree holders. So again, according to NCES data, when comparing master's degrees conferred in 2005 to those in 2014, they increased by 57.7% among the Black community, by 85.5% among Latinos, and by 34.7% among Asian Pacific Islanders. So that is, in the 2015-26 academic year, BIPOC were 34% of bachelor's degree holders, 33% of master's degree holders, but only approximately, as a group, as a total, make up 10% of our profession. Next slide. So racial and ethnic diversity in our field requires action, recruitment, and cultivation. You know, many of the existing national diversity initiatives often focus on students that are already poised to enter the profession. Our work and this presentation is about getting to the root, and we'll focus on what we have the agency to do in our respective day-to-day positions to begin to tackle those barriers. Number one is to create interest to combat the lack of awareness. Number two is to transform our spaces and rethink our practices to make our institutions, our reading rooms, our spaces less intimidating and more friendly and inclusive. And three is to create opportunities for students to feel seen and included.
So just to talk about what we're doing at Cal State LA to help in diversifying the field is, and as Amalia mentioned earlier, special collections and archives units are inherently exclusive and elite spaces due to the rarity of the materials we collect. However, there are various strategies that we can implement in our respective institutions to collectively work towards creating an environment that is less intimidating, friendly, inclusive, student and community centered. At Cal State LA, we have implemented a special collections and archives student assistant program that provides opportunities for students interested in the library science, archival, and museum fields. Student assistants are paired with collections and projects related to their area of interest and field of study. Working closely with special collections staff, students build a program that aligns with their academic goals and interests. The program began organically with one student assistant when I first started, and we've had 10 student assistants at a time. Student assistants participate in various aspects of the department, from processing collections, reference services, class instruction, public programming, collection development, digitization projects, and exhibitions. And just to talk a little bit about our hiring process, we usually require a cover letter along with the resume to apply for the program. The interviewing process includes a tour of special collections and archives by a current student assistant and an interview with three members of the special collections and archives personnel. We have developed a rubric to assess each candidate's application materials and the actual interview. The hiring process has allowed student assistants to gain experience and know what it's like to interview in the library profession. They learn the process and also participate in it once they are hired. We also provide an orientation and an opportunity for students' assistants to get to know each other once they first get started. And the orientation includes an introduction to special collections and our specific collecting subject areas. We also invite student assistants that have completed the program to be part of the orientation to talk to incoming students about their experience in the program. The idea behind the orientation is for student assistants not only to get an introduction to the department and understand what Special Collections and Archives is all about, but also to interact with other students and start to develop the teamwork environment. After the orientation, I meet one-on-one with each student to further gauge their interests and customize the program to their learning objectives and the needs of the department.
So identifying potential is key, and it's not always black and white. So for example, well, the thought of requiring a cover letter, even a brief cover letter for a student job seems really onerous. But when we did this at Cal State LA, we didn't ask for more than like 3/4 to a page. And this strategy allowed us to narrow down a pool of hundreds of student applications that we typically receive. And I'm sure that's the case for many of your institutions for student jobs. And we also created flyers about the student job with images and friendly language. We posted the flyers and sent them to faculty across different departments. It was a lot of legwork, but it worked. And I think it was really worth the time and effort because students submitted great applications and brief but good cover letters. In a lot of cases, they were referred to by their students, by their instructors. Professors recommended them based on, what they knew about the student, having worked with the student. And again, we got really, really great applicants. So library experience, of course, was not required because our students oftentimes have just retail backgrounds or have worked in the food industry. Those cover letters allowed us to really gauge their interests and identify other transferable skills. Like just as a brief example, one of our students, she was an anthropology undergrad. She only had experience working for parking at Disneyland, and had it not been for that cover letter and encouragement from her professor to apply, we wouldn't have gotten to know her. She wrote really great cover letter, I think one of the best ones we've had, but her, her experience and maybe her application wouldn't have really reflected in interest. And this is a student that was with Cal State LA, I believe, for like a year and a half as a student, and she's now recently graduated and is now interested in pursuing an MLIS.
And just to talk a little bit about the approach that we take with the student assistant program at Cal State LA. I've implemented the constructive pedagogical approach in my management and teaching style. The article by Sylvia Vong in 2016, A Constructivist Approach for Introducing Undergraduate Students to Special Collections and Archives Research, Vong states that constructivism entrusts the students to create their own learning experiences by participating in activities, while the teacher's role is to create an environment that promotes students to inquire, discuss, and reflect on new ideas. This approach has allowed me to view each student as an individual with various facets, unique experiences, and perspectives, which can add a lot of value to the daily work of an Archives and Special Collections department. Together, we create a space of authentic and genuine dialogue, which builds trust and creates an environment of creativity and expression. I found this approach to be very effective when engaging with BIPOC students, and it has really enriched my work as an archivist. So although the constructivist approach is a teaching model, I have adapted it for the student assistant work environment. So here's a chart that I've implemented using the constructivist approach, which is on the left-hand side of the chart. And then the right-hand side, you can see some of the work tasks and activities assigned to students. So the constructivist approach is to connect between prior knowledge to new knowledge. So I usually assign a processing project to each student that reflects their interests or expertise. So if a student is interested in photography, then they usually work on a collection that has photographs in it. Or if they're from a particular, their hometown is Compton or a certain area, then we give them a collection that reflects that if I have it. So the whole point is to have a processing project or a collection that reflects their current interests or knowledge. Then they gain new knowledge where they learn archival practice and best standards. And then they, as far as the constructivist approach, there's also social interaction between students or students and other supervisors. So we have regular group meetings and individual check-ins. This creates a space to discuss issues, concerns, ideas, and current projects that we all are working on. I also share with students the projects that I work on, and students also share what they've been working on as well. I've noticed that this creates a really inclusive environment, and it also can spur up new projects. And then real life tasks or experiences that relate to new knowledge. So students are assigned real life tasks that I do sometimes in my process as a library professional. So developing proposals, attending meetings, assisting researchers, give tours to demonstrate a real life scenario on the job. And this gives them an opportunity to implement the new knowledge that they've learned as being part of the student assistant program and able to implement this in a proposal that they can create in meetings they're attending and have conversations about their work. And then lastly is activities that promote reflection on one's own learning and experience or experiences. So students also reflect on their own projects and experience through an exhibition, public programming event, social media campaign, or research project. So they're able to tie in, again, the prior knowledge that they've gained and the new knowledge that they've, or the prior knowledge that they had before they were student assistants and their interests, and then tie that together with the new knowledge, which is the archival practice and what they learn as a student assistant, and be able to reflect on that process through a research project or an exhibition. And student assistants that have gone through the program are undergraduate and graduate students. They range from various majors, from art and graphic design, art history, computer science, English, history, anthropology, communications, television and film, Latin American studies, Chicano studies, and mathematics. They have worked and taken courses and volunteered and interned at various institutions, which include the Library of Congress, LACMA, the Natural History Museum, the Getty Research Institute, the Museum of Social Justice, the University of Chicago, and the NASA History Division. So those are just a couple of examples. And also to just also my fellow presenters today, Amalia and Karina, were also previous student assistants in the program. And as you can see, our work continues to intersect and we provide continued support for each other within the profession. And so with that being said, the personnel involved in these types of programs need to be intentional with their efforts and passionate about this work. In addition, the department and institution must hold diversity initiatives as a priority and go beyond stating it in a mission statement, but implementing it in everyday operations from collection development, policies and procedures, instruction, reference services, public programming, archival processing, and providing some mentorship and guidance for students that are interested. All of these are key in engaging with BIPOC students.
Fostering and mentoring students should be done intentionally and practiced daily in our libraries. So building trust, listening to students, and assigning them various department roles and responsibilities are all factors for their success. So this doesn't mean that we need to figure out, you know, one specific formula or micromanage students, but it can be done as simply and consistently as, you know, checking on a weekly basis, one-on-one talks for guidance on their assignments and projects. So we just need to actively break away from like these institutional power dynamics and acknowledge that library workers can learn from BIPOC experiences that help enrich the collection scope. So a combination of student engagement and constructivist pedagogical approach and dismantling power dynamics is needed. Next slide. So we also need to make an effort to provide the resources for students navigating academia and professionalism. So student assistants, especially first gen BIPOC, might not be familiar with interacting with professors, administration, and librarians outside of the classroom. So having student assistants be responsible to assist visitors at the front desk, like especially of a reading room, helps them interact professionally with academic researchers. So overseeing research appointments can also show students they're a major component in librarianship and then in the creation of other scholarship. So, you know, whether it be for answering quick reference questions or managing a day-long appointment, it serves as valuable experience. So by empowering them to interact with all kinds of patrons, they can expand their professional networks and just enhance their overall knowledge of the collections. So when I was a student at, you know, Cal State LA, the East LA archives at the special collections there interested me personally, because I was born and raised there, and I was able to participate in the creation of a Chicano activist related exhibit. So I assisted with the exhibit that featured Chicano activist and photographer Raul Reese. So he helped with the creation of La Raza, an independent newspaper that was featured in the exhibit. And I helped create labels and mounted them. So talking to him actually helped with identifying some of the photos in the collection that, you know, we had no idea where they came from. So this is just an instance where I felt represented, and it drove me to pursue a career in archives. So students often are unfamiliar because they haven't been exposed to archival research. So student assistants can act as representatives and create a less exclusive atmosphere and just have them leave with a positive impression. And it just motivates our diverse demographic of students to potentially study, research, and or work here. So representation obviously goes beyond just motivation, but it can lead to a more diverse and inclusive field. Next slide. Actively including student assistance with class collaborations and instruction is a must if we want to address student success. So it also serves to strengthen teamwork amongst the department as well. Student assistance, educational, cultural, and archival knowledge can provide different perspectives, critiques, and techniques for the future of the department. So their involvement in instruction can help also break down these power dynamics and especially in, enhance primary source research. So including student assistants with primary source instruction highlights their archival processing skills, as, you know, Azalea mentioned, new ideas or ways of thinking about the primary sources, collection development, exhibitions, and so forth can be developed with their inclusion. So when I helped with class instruction in Azalea's program, I remember pushing students to be critical of materials contents. So I often led discussions with like critical questions like, you know, what's missing in this? How are people being described in this, you know, in this material? And try to resonate with their research interests. So I even had the opportunity to assist librarians with primary source instruction sessions. And at that time I was researching, you know, for my thesis paper on Mexican American women in the 70s that were coerced to sterilizations in LA hospitals. So I chose to present on a magazine from our archives that critiqued the medical procedure as an example of a primary source. So I wanted to show how close to home this was, especially for BIPOC students. And it was great to see others take interest and share my archival and cultural knowledge for their coursework. So we should acknowledge their archival skills and take note of their critical knowledge and provide space for them to shine. And it also goes beyond empowerment. And it provides great career growth that is often not available if you have these, you know, you don't have this internal connections, like especially as a first gen. You know, when you have socioeconomic disparities and, you know, historical injustice, you know, against you. So they often do not have these academic connections and must figure it out through their college experience. Next slide. So from my experience as a student assistant at, you know, Cal State LA, my team at Fresno State tries to take those similar intentional practices with class collaborations. So we collaborated on a physical and digital exhibit solely on one of our collections, the Topolobampo collection. And it touches on the Topolobampo colony founded in Mexico by American colonists in the late 1800s. It contains a variety of handwritten letters, songs, books, and maps that students use to analyze utopian concepts. And they were challenged to think critically about the colony and identify what ideologies manifest, but also find, you know, the silences within the archives. For the most part, it revolves around the colonist perspective and not the indigenous Mexicans or locals. So students critically approached the materials, and the archives assisted with empowering students, teaching them about, you know, archival procedures and primary research methods. Next slide. So these are some of the results from their interdisciplinary research. And it was, you know, part of it was the digital exhibition that showed images like the middle one through Omeka. And they also created a sort of a collection of essays and anthology on what they found in the collection. And they also touched on topics like race, gender, and the othering of, you know, Mexican natives. And the flyer, the third image, also shows how this class collaboration led into other great events connected to Black history in particular. So, and these are things, you know, especially the events that came out of this, like these were things that I didn't even really think of when looking at this collection. So it really goes to show how like students and class collaborations can lead to very creative projects. Next slide. And then we can also foster student agency by listening to BIPOC students' personal experiences and providing projects that can relate to their passions and strengths. So student assistants like Lorenzo came into Special Collections with great graphic design skills, and he designed this book plate to promote the collections. And he now runs his own graphic design business. Kwang, my student from Fresno State, a Vietnamese student, was involved in the editing for our Japanese American oral history project. He later volunteered with Q-Story, an oral history project to preserve LGBTQ voices from the Central Valley, that was also run by campus professors on, you know, the middle image. He was able to bridge his archival experience and his interest in the LGBTQ plus community with this. And I also briefly wanted to mention another of my students, June, a Hmong student that now works at Tesla. So she didn't go into librarianship, but she's let me know that like her experience with metadata, you know, inputting it in the archives, is still applicable to the kind of work she's doing. And she also leads a team there, which she was already doing with our student assistants. And student agency also means visibility and credibility for their work. So like with finding aids, exhibitions, and other projects. But if we want more BIPOC participation in the archives and librarianship in general, we need to build long-term connections and advocate for their student success and, you know, their aspirations as well.
So engaging BIPOC students with collections that reflect their communities and relate to their interests is a great way to introduce archives as a potential career field, as Karina mentioned earlier. And just to give you an example of a student at Cal State LA, her name is Stephanie Bravo. She started off as an intern and then became a student assistant. I met her through a class instruction session in Special Collections and Archives. Through the class presentation, I highlighted the Compton Communicative Arts Academy, which is composed of photographic materials that document African-American art and culture and community-based art making in Los Angeles in the 1970s. After the class session, Stephanie asked me about the collection and discussed her research on the Compton murals, and she also mentioned that Compton was her hometown. By highlighting the collection, she was automatically able to relate and began to feel comfortable in the space. Not too comfortable, but she started to feel comfortable because there was some representation on her hometown. At this time, we had an internship opportunity for Cal State LA students interested in archives, and right away I knew Stephanie would be a great fit. I went out of my way to recruit her and convince her that this opportunity would be a great fit for her academic aspirations. I approached her several times as she conducted research in the reading room, and even asked Amalia, who is a presenter here, at the time she was a student assistant, to help in recruiting her. So it took several times to get her to feel comfortable, and eventually she applied and did an amazing job as an intern that I hired her on as a student assistant. The internship included processing a collection, developing an exhibit, which tied to the intern scholarly interest. Stephanie worked on processing the Compton Communicative Arts Academy. The exhibit that she developed with her fellow intern centered on alternative ways ways Latinx and Black populations in Los Angeles document their histories through non-institutional methods. They both performed beyond my expectations, and they were inspired by the murals in Compton and painted their own mural to reflect the two collections in the exhibit. You can see part of the mural. So the mural was actually painted to large scale, and they included that in the exhibition, but they also took a picture of it and included it on the flyer here. So you can see part of the mural of the two faces on the flyer. That's what they created or painted on their own, and they were inspired by the Compton murals. After processing the collection in 2017, Stephanie continued documenting the city's landscapes for future generations by launching the Hub City Photo Archive website, which compares past images of Compton to recent developments in the city. And Stephanie has developed the website, which includes more of her current research, since she is currently a dual doctoral student in the Department of English and Chicano Latino Studies program at Michigan State. And as this example demonstrates, that beyond giving students a job, the program provides students the skills and experience to enhance their academic careers and contribute to their student success. I have noticed that throughout the years, the student assistants begin to gain confidence as they are given the opportunity to initiate and execute their own projects. In turn, students are more invested in their work and feel their voices and ideas are valued. The skills and experiences that they learn make them competitive in pursuing PhD programs, MLIS programs, and positions in the field. So not only collaborating with students is key, but also with faculty. Together, history faculty member and I explored various options to engage undergraduate students beyond the classroom setting by embedding archival practice throughout an undergraduate race and ethnicity history course. This collaboration was founded on developing a project-based active learning experience through teaching history, archival practice, and primary source analysis. The course focused on race and ethnicity's intersections with culture, gender, and socioeconomic class in American history. Students in two sections of the course learned how to process and interpret the personal papers of Marvin Dimley, an immigrant from Trinidad that came to the US in 1946. And he was also an alumnus of Cal State LA. He served as a California State Assemblyman and was the first Black Lieutenant Governor of California. One section of the class worked on processing his photographs, while the other section worked on the correspondence. The final exam was an analysis of a select group of primary sources that were discovered by the students during the processing activity. Despite the campus closure due to COVID-19 pandemic, we continued this project remotely. The project transitioned from processing to developing a virtual exhibit. This semester, we also included a label writing component to the course with the correspondence and photographs that were used from the previous semester. In order to support the project, we applied for a Cal Humanities Quick Grant to develop the project into a three-part series of events to highlight the students' work and the collection. The series includes a community speaker panel, online exhibition, and virtual gallery tour led by students, and a co-host virtual event with educators and curators. These events will be held this spring 2021, so we're still working on this project currently. The COVID-19 pandemic and the outcry for racial justice has impacted the lives of everyone, especially the Black community in the US. Now more than ever, in these changing times, it is important to continue to do our work to contribute to diversifying the profession, even if it means finding new ways to engage BIPOC students through the virtual learning environment. So now Karina will go ahead and talk about some of the efforts that they have been working on at Fresno State.
Yeah, so I wanted to briefly mention how my library is working on student engagement in our virtual environment. So more than ever, we have to highlight Special Collections and Archives' connection and impact on, you know, student success on our campus. Next slide. So the hands-on experience we facilitated before is out of the picture for now. But there are other strategies for active and embedded learning. So many institutions are adapting by providing virtual resources like tours, videos with introductions to the collections, creating course packets or, you know, kind of simplified lesson plans, and collecting materials on prevalent issues like COVID and social justice, which, you know, a lot of institutions are already doing. So I've assisted with curating materials for classroom instruction related to ethnic studies, Black power, civil rights, and water rights. And it seems like these issues are more relevant than ever, and creating sample packets of these various collections in our archives can introduce students to our space in a different manner, right? So we hope to highlight BIPOC local history and integrate it into the current push for student success. And often BIPOC-centered collections are quote unquote hidden, or there's no fiscal support for their digitization. So we recently held a virtual tour with our team at Special Collections, collaborating with development, and are already receiving good feedback from it. So we made sure to highlight BIPOC-related collections on topics like farm workers' rights, the Japanese American internment, and our campus's ethnic studies movement. So talking about BIPOC history and tours and other virtual events is a clear example of representation, but it can also develop into potential projects. So one example of this is the digitization project for our Grapevine magazine. It's the cover is the middle image. And it's a magazine that captured Black culture in the Central Valley. So we're currently working on that project, and you know, we're working also with our Africana studies on campus. Next slide. And there are countless of obstacles, especially as we work from home or other barriers, but advocating for students can still remain a priority. So although our institution allows limited research appointments with the proper COVID-19 guidelines, it was limited to campus staff and faculty, but interestingly enough, they weren't very keen on entering the building, but we did have multiple students pushing to come in. So we noticed that most of these students were Latinx and grad students. So that kind of reflects on what Amalia's statistics earlier on in the presentation. And they're interested in coming in to explore the collections. So we decided to advocate for students' needs to enter the building with library administration, and we were able to assist them safely. So even in these circumstances, students are very eager to interact with the archives, and we can adopt our institutional power to meet their needs.
So at Cal State LA, I just want to talk briefly about how we've also transitioned to the virtual environment, especially the student assistant program that I described earlier. So because I know a lot of campuses, they no longer have a student assistant budget. And luckily we've been able to sustain that at Cal State LA for our Special Collections and Archives Department. And it's because Special Collections and Archives staff are really dedicated to justifying why we need a student assistant budget at this time by moving our focus from physical to the digital projects. Also justifying the importance of these projects and impact to student success, and how our new projects or digital projects align with the priorities of the library and the department's strategic directions. Students are currently working on backlog digital projects and new initiatives such as our Pandemic Diaries project, which include metadata creation and transcription. They're also working on oral history projects that we didn't get a chance to really work on as far as the transcription work when we were on campus. So they're able to work on those types of projects remotely. And before COVID-19 hit, we were really focused at Cal State LA on the physical exhibits program, but didn't really focus on virtual exhibits or digital humanities projects. So now we're working on that more now. We are also trying new ways to provide Special Collections and Archives reference services. So being experimental with that, we have implemented a new library chat service that is monitored by student assistants from Monday through Fridays from 10 to 5 p.m. And they answer questions about our open hours. So if we're open during COVID-19, if we provide remote digitization, those types of questions. And in order to try to emulate the teamwork environment that we had in our physical space, I've implemented regular group meetings and check-ins on how, just to provide a way for people to communicate, or students also to communicate with me. They're not required, but we do provide them regularly and record them for students who've missed it. We've also pursued more grant opportunities. In the grant opportunities that we've currently seeked out, we always try to include a student assistant position to continue to provide jobs for our current assistants. A lot of our current student assistants are almost graduating, so we want to make sure that we can still give them the experience by giving them an opportunity to be part of these grant projects. And I continue to provide mentorship and support for students in applying to positions in the field and in internship scholarship opportunities, which includes assistance with their application materials and providing mock interviews for them. And during this time, I've had quite several students reach out to me to discuss their interest in library school, or students that have already graduated and are currently in graduate school to discuss what they're currently experiencing in their programs. So I think the overall message here with the mentorship and support is that even beyond the student assistant program, we still try to continue to mentor and support students as they navigate through MLIS programs, as they navigate into the field. And that's been a really important part to me, is to help still guide students in that process.
Okay, so in the case of, you know, many of the CSUs and several of the UCs, you know, racial and ethnic diversity is one of our strengths. But whether your campus has many BIPOC and first generation, non-traditional and returning students or not, our experience renders several outreach goals super important in either context. Next slide. So for starters, we should work to make the archives more accessible, right? And I know that many of us are doing just that. And there are a couple of questions we can ask ourselves, right? How easy is it to find the reading room? What's the vibe of the space? Is it intimidating? How easy is it to make an appointment? Are we actively deconstructing modes of exclusivity? For example, by the types of IDs we may require, signage, is there a lot of, like, you know, a lot of signs with red on it that's been kind of intimidated or restrictive? Are the doors open to the reading room? Are they locked? Also thinking through the type of language that we use when engaging with student users, this is really huge, right? Just if the student is, you know, roaming around the space or in the lobby or comes into the reading room, are we saying, hi, welcome, good morning, or are we saying, how can I help you? Next slide. So other strategies are, of course, to showcase collections that resonate with the student body. And of course, I know many archives and institutions are already doing this great work. And this one is huge, right? Let's not underestimate the power of seeing one's stories represented. And BIPOC, frankly, that's not really something we see growing up, from imagery to the types of books and novels we read in school. So displays and exhibitions about collections that can resonate with various racial and ethnic groups is really, really critical to bring in the students into the archive beyond this instruction. Just anecdotally, I can say that when I worked at Cal State LA, so many students would actually come and ask, hey, there's this exhibit downstairs, I'm interested in this book, or can you tell me more about it, or that's really cool. So it really kind of created that sort of natural cycle of interest and curiosity. And most importantly, of course, is also having students from those communities do the work of curation and research for these exhibits or these displays. This, of course, means, you know, gauging whether the student is interested or not. But, you know, one can see the value of having a student assist or lead an exhibit or a pop-up exhibit or even a larger exhibit versus one led by, like, a faculty or a staff member in the archive. So if a student creates something, they, of course, they're going to share it with their peers. They're going to share it with their instructors, maybe even some of their networks outside of campus, like activist organizations, community organizations. And then this is, of course, going to create just a natural cycle of outreach. So if outreach, you know, outside of the archives or even within the institution. So this is, you know, outreach that is genuine, it is authentic, and it has a lot of heart. Next slide. So as you saw in our presentation, these were some examples of the work that has developed over the course of our career. Next slide. When I came into Dominguez Hills, I took on the coordination of the LibCats program, an initiative of our library dean's office that aims to expose students to library careers. I was really excited to take on this in my new role, having done the work that I did at Cal State LA and having been part of it myself at one point. So this program is structured as a 6-week program consisting of presentations and career panels. And this image here is of pre-COVID times of a panel in the fall when I first arrived on campus. And this was, again, a good, really good starting point to start to build relationships. It was a panel that I coordinated with our career center. Again, I established a relationship with an advisor and, you know, help with the promotion of it. And our campus is 90% students BIPOC. So it was really, really great to see a pretty good turnout and really, really curious students that seem to be enthusiastic about learning about our profession. So again, it was, you know, a sort of a natural transition to work with Azalea and Karina because we had all worked at Cal State LA at one point, and then suddenly we were all dispersed among three different CSU campuses. So again, we came together and joined our efforts to do this work. And now we are starting these conversations with our CSU sister campuses. It, you know, sort of naturally happened, and our colleagues and the CSU roundtable reached out to us, and yesterday we presented about this work, and we'll continue to have conversations about what we can continue to do together as a system, not just this year, but in the future and throughout the work that we do in our careers.
And then just some final thoughts that we wanted to leave you all with is, you know, like the realities of the profession. And by that, I mean like every campus, every archive and library is gonna implement their own form of BIPOC inclusion. We're not offering a cookie cutter like formula, but, you know, especially like in, you know, there's, you know, a plethora of institutions. Like my institution is in the rural valley, the San Joaquin Valley of California. So we don't have like, you know, an abundance of resources compared to other larger institutions, but that shouldn't stop you from advocating for BIPOC inclusion, whether it be with more student involvement with courses, internships, or employment, or highlighting the BIPOC collections. All of those things can advocate for diversity on your campus. And then students acquire, you know, transferable skills, and that should be highlighted in our within the field. So, you know, we don't expect every single student to become a library-like worker, staff, or faculty, but we do want to be intentional to expose them to this very impactful field that they might have not known they were stepping into. So even if our campus doesn't have a library science program, it shouldn't stop you from, you know, encouraging them, you know, to take a different career pathway.
Also, too, don't underestimate the importance of soft skills. Soft skills have more to do with who you are rather than what you know. Always keep in mind that soft skills you have developed over the years can help you engage with BIPOC students in meaningful ways and can impact their academic success. And this also ties to the other final thought, which is genuine interest. So, you know, show your genuine interest in your career in the field. Let students know why you decided to take on this career and the aspects you genuinely enjoy about it. Let this come across to students as you engage with them in the reading room, research consultations, class instruction sessions, your public program events, etc. Sometimes we get caught up with our daily responsibilities that we forget why we entered this profession. Remember why you became interested in the field and invite students into your personal journey into this career field.
And then, you know, while this presentation doesn't describe it in depth, we also want to say that we are acutely aware of the structural barriers that keep BIPOC out of this profession. We're also aware of the ways in which, you know, achieving racial and ethnic diversity alone is not enough, right? If the dominant culture and its ideas persist within our institutions and just our daily practices. So resolving those issues is part of a collective challenge that we all have. But we hope that this conversation has inspired you to continue the work that you're doing or begin this work with the resources that, you know, you do have now within your institution and within, you know, your agency in your role. And I also want to mention, and this, you know, this is something that we discussed with our CSU colleagues yesterday. And I also want to really emphasize to not shy away from feeling like you're misleading students by bringing them into this field, or because, you know, getting into the field is challenging and really difficult as it is. We're really honest and we make that really clear to our students. We don't shy away from that. But what we don't want to do is miss the opportunity to cultivate prospective talented students that would make great librarians, archivists, and future library leaders. You know, not all of them will choose to pursue this field, but it is certain is that if we provide them with fruitful experiences, they will walk away with the appreciation for the work of archives that is, you know, lifelong. And, you know, they'll walk away with transferable skills that they can apply to other career paths. But we are witnessing these rapid demographic changes. BIPOC are in many of our institutions in California. So I think we just have a whole generation of students that we can inspire. And like I said, not all of them are gonna be archivists or librarians, but we're potentially, you know, missing out on bringing those students in. And lastly, you know, because we have seen just looking at the statistics and how things have changed over time, when we're talking about over 30% of BIPOC are in our universities, and this is nationwide. And, you know, in California, those numbers are even higher, right? In the CSU alone, BIPOC make up, I think, well over 50%, or maybe even close to 60%, or maybe even higher. So we've seen that the passive approach doesn't work, and, you know, the profession isn't going to change on its own, and the transformation requires the work of all of us.
I think we can now, that concludes our presentation. I believe we have a couple of minutes to answer any questions. Oh.
Great, well, there's been some great questions that have come in, so I'll just go in order that they came in. The first one is, are your student assistants funded by work study?
Yes, some of them are, some of them aren't. So the majority of them aren't. Right now I have two that are. And we didn't know they were work study until recently. So the work study funds were helpful during COVID-19 pandemic because there were budget cuts in the student assistant budget.
Okay, the next question is, how do we as a profession address the lack of positions that are based on, that are grant based? How do we retain those recent graduates?
That's a tough one. I think what I would say, because I think when I, having been a student assistant and graduated, I think the emphasis in the program, and something that I, Azalea and I had a lot of conversations around, was like, getting as much experience possible and making yourself competitive, and just networking to kind of expose students to other possibilities. Because again, we aren't shy of the fact that, yeah, it's really hard to find a position after, and you may have to be flexible and moving. Like Karina, you know, she was in LA and she went to Fresno to get that a first experience. And again, we're aware that not all the students have that flexibility, but it's just exposing them to that and knowing, like, hey, you know, you want to start networking and even going to archives conferences as a non-MLIS student, which is something I did, and really kind of driving that home to make the students know that it is bigger beyond their institutions, but the possibilities are out there, but it is hard.
The next question is, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Well, we can go because we don't have that much time, but yeah, we could ask the next question.
We've got a good amount of questions. Going back to your analysis of the ACRL guidelines, what changes or interventions might need to take place for primary source introduction to foster personalized learning experiences for students? Do you think the ACRL guidelines already address this?
Can you ask the question again? That one's a tough one too.
You bet. So it's about the ACRL guidelines. What changes or interventions might need to take place for primary source instruction to foster personalized learning experiences for students? And do the guidelines already address this?
I think it depends. I think, you know, some of us, when we do some of the primary source teaching in classes, it does take us to collaborate with faculty members. And I think to personalize it, you know, you have to probably go beyond the ACRL framework and really go with collaborating with the faculty member on that, and building those personalized experiences within in instruction sessions. I've had the opportunity to work with faculty at Cal State LA for quite some time, and it's taken us a while to build those personalized experiences with students in their class. There's three professors that I actively work with where I've built my relationship with them. And this is where the soft skills come in, where we talk about this, where, you know, try to, I know sometimes we think in special collections and archives we're in this department, but I think try your best to collaborate with other people and faculty on campus if you're working in a academic institution, to try to get yourself into those classes and try to tell them your ideas and how you can help them with their learning strategies and their learning outcomes and how that fits within your framework to create that personalized experience in the classroom.
The next question is, as a Latina professionals who have transitioned to this predominantly white profession, how do you balance care for yourselves with BIPOC student advocacy? Do you feel a cultural tax to represent? How can non-BIPOC professionals support you? And then there's a comment, many thanks. I'm so grateful for your efforts on this front by the questioner.
Thank you, Stephanie. So I feel like sometimes, you know, the question, I mean, she's asking a few questions that are very, you know, they hit a lot of points, but, you know, about the cold, you know, sometimes you're just kind of put into certain positions, right? Like you're not even kind of asked, like you're just kind of like, oh, you're diverse for our campus. You're going to be part of the diversity committee, you know, like, so, I mean, a lot of the work, a lot of this labor is on BIPOC staff and faculty, when it should just be a more holistic approach. So I do agree with, you know, some of the suggestions on this needs to be part of like a full revamp of how we interact with students, and it shouldn't just be the responsibility of BIPOC staff and faculty to recruit BIPOC students. This should be an investment by everyone who cares about diversity and inclusion on their campus.
Okay, the next question is, implicit bias is a huge factor. We need to seriously address inclusion and belonging to attract BIPOC students, interns, and staff. So I guess that's a comment. Okay, next question. For those institutions who haven't been able to successfully advocate for a student employee budget, what do you recommend doing in this time?
I know that's something that our department does. I am at Dominguez Hills, is that students are able to receive academic credit and they do a project with an archive. So they're like an intern for a semester, and they'll, you know, it depending on, you know, the scope of the project, the interest of the student. And then again, they get, you know, they write a paper and they get how many ever units their department grants. So I know that that's definitely a possibility. I know that when I was a graduate student at Cal State LA, I did that, not with the archives, but with the museum. So I was able to get academic credit for an independent study. So that's, I think, one possible way. It is something that I think more than ever, it's really more labor on us as staff, but it's a labor of love and really being able to kind of help the student, because I think Azalea can attest to the times we, you know, train students or interns. It really is a great opportunity for us to learn as much as students. So again, that's a potential starting point if the budget is, you know, non-existent.
I think also too, I mean, if you need to keep on advocating for it. So like if they tell you no once, try it again and try it again and try to match it try to make sure you justify it with some of the priorities of that your strategic directions in your current institution or the priorities of what's happening and how that can impact, if you're in a academic institution, how that impacts student success. I think that's been a strategy of ours to be able to get a student assistant budget consistently, even during this time. So I think continue to ask for it. You'll probably be, you know, don't take the no for the answer. Just continue to ask for it and why it's going to be important for your particular department and institution.
The next question is, how can the Society of California Archivists help your institutions and others to expand and diversify both our student and professional workforce in the archival field?
I would say just right off, just thinking about how we can collectively either, you know, just outreach efforts collectively, whether it's, you know, through these panels, but maybe even more organized efforts where we're kind of working together. One thing that I always say sort of jokingly is like our profession, you know, we need to sort of rethink our whole PR campaign, right? Because when we see ourselves represented in movies or, you know, sort of in the public, it's like they have it all wrong. And I always find myself, right, like, you know, letting my peers or family members know a little bit about what we do because they just don't have it right. And neither do our students. So kind of rethinking about that as a whole in sort of how we approach this, you know, new generation of upcoming professionals. I know that's really big and large, but I think, you know, that's part of it.
And I think it's also just addressing why, like, you know, that's the big question. Like, you know, we're trying to include them, but like, you know, I think we should think of all the, you know, what are these obstacles that they're facing? Like maybe even like, because honestly, like, you know, it's very jarring to see those stats, right? That there's more than ever, there's so many BIPOC grad students, and why aren't we seeing more of them, you know, in the field? So I don't know. I think it's complicated and I think it has to, I mean, it is complicated because there's also so many people involved within this one word, right? So like we have to think about like what's missing with, you know, why aren't Black students in the archives? Why aren't Indigenous students in the archives? And this is like a whole, like, you know, it's a huge issue. So I think we need to like crack down on each group.
And I think it's just being open, like SEA, having panels like this, as Amalia mentioned, and continue to do that. I think that's going to be help to change the culture a little bit where we're having these discussions. And I think that's probably the way to start doing it.
I would say just embedding it into what we do versus just kind of, you know, I mean, of course, and it's the generations before that have done that, and we're kind of building on that, but really embedding it into the work that we do, because that's one point that I think the leaders from the CSU roundtable brought up yesterday, which was really great, is like, oh, this conversation sort of ignited this, and this is really exciting, and really happy to hear this. Let's continue this conversation. It's like, let's find ways to embed it in more of what we do. And of course, that's part of it. I mean, you know, BIPOC, we're here, where we've been, you know, where you come into undergrad, and we're going more, you know, we're getting into grad school, and we're just kind of going without really thinking about our libraries and archives, even if we're like technically in the spaces.
We We got one more question. Go ahead.
There is actually a couple of other questions that I skipped because there's questions asked by the same person. I wanted to make sure everybody's voice was represented. Yeah. So how much time do we have to go through?
Can we go maybe a few more minutes if that's okay?
Okay. So how might a student-centered approach help transform the ways we think about recruitment and retention of BIPOC professionals? Do library professionals need more training to create authentic interactions and engagement with students who might potentially have a future in the field? Should librarians focus on engagement with student employee experiences, the classroom, or both? Packed question.
Yeah, I think you can have an impact either way. I think if you have the opportunity to have a student assistant budget and being able to have student assistants, then you'd be able to engage them and build the program. Even if you just have enough for one student assistant or an intern, depending on your institution, I think you can have an impact and get that student's opinion and have them have a voice in some of the things that have been, some of the policies or procedures and things like that, or participation. For instance, at Cal State LA, we did have a student that mentioned that our collection, that we lacked some communities in our collection, and we certainly did, and they can pick up on some of that. And she recommended we collect in a specific area in Central Americans in Los Angeles. And so we started developing a collection on that. And we also talked about, you know, Afro-Latinidad, and so things like that. So even one student that you interact with can provide a great opportunity and insight on starting to develop things and grow things that reflect the student population and the community that you're part of. Also too, if you can't have student assistants, you can have impactful interactions with students in the classroom, or even in the reading room when you're providing reference. Even now that we are on chat, even on the chat, you're not answering, it's not through email, just trying to create those real personal kind of experiences, I think really go a long way. And I think perhaps maybe training in this area would be great. I also think it's great, like we mentioned before about the soft skills and interacting with our colleagues as well, and how to provide these opportunities so that it's not only in special collections, but it can be across library, you know, across various library departments.
Yeah, and I will just add to another way that I think about it too, is just seeing our students as potential future professionals or maybe even future colleagues, right? And really kind of tapping into their skills. And I say this from experience, because when I started working as a student with Azalea, I had worked a full-time job. I switched fields. I was an adult, you know? So it's like, it was student, of course, right? And there were certain, you know, responsibilities of staff and faculty that we can't put on students, but you kind of gauge the student and tap into their skills and see, and maybe progressively give them different opportunities to you know, do work that meets their skill set. Like, they're adults, right? Right? So that I'm seeing them as that. And I felt like when I was working at Cal State, even when I was a student and I eventually became, you know, full-time staff there, I was always treated the same way even when I was a student, as an adult that I was. Right. And as a potential future archivist that was really excited about this work. So kind of switching that mindset and keeping that in mind when we're working with our students.
So the next question is, do you think that it might be possible to work with K-12 schools to familiarize students with the work we do?
Yes, I don't want to keep, but feel free to chime in, Azalea. This is also something in the time that I was there and the few years that I was there, we actually, because Cal State LA is very community connected, so there are just tours all the time, and students would come into, I know Azalea got some requests from, it was high school students at one point, another point it was middle school students, so we kind of prepared a presentation that was like catered to them. It was like a tour where we took them to the rare book stuff and the reading room. And the students were excited. They thought the rare book room was the coolest thing. And we, of course, brought, you know, community collections that resonated them related to East LA. And the students loved it. So that it did ignite that interest. And I think, of course, that was just one example through tours. But of course, there's a lot of potential to kind of go out and engage the students and talk to them about like, hey, you can be a librarian, too, right? So.
What was really great about that is we did have these high school tours or K through 12 tours, but we also incorporated the student assistants so that way the high school students or K through 12 students can see, you know, somebody who's currently a college student working in this and also talking about this and showing their interest in this and connecting with them because they might connect better with them than with me, you know. So yeah.
So there's just a couple of comments and notifications. So one comment is library training and certificate programs at community colleges and two-year programs are also a good way to connect with more BIPOC students. And then another comment about the Knowledge River program at University of Arizona's iSchool does recruitment for BIPOC students interested in an MA for library science. There's recruitment going on now for summer and fall in 2021.
All right, well, thank you so much, Azalea, Amalia, and Karina for taking the time and going over time to share insight and strategies into organizing efforts and considerations to provide mentorship and meaningful professional development opportunities to the field. And thank you also to both Mallory and Adrian for facilitating this webinar. And thank you everyone for taking the time to participate today. If you all have a minute to spare, we'd really welcome your feedback through a quick survey that will pop up following this presentation. If you have any suggestions for our next webinar, please weigh in. One more comment that just came in, a very thoughtful and rich presentation, so many good ideas shared. Thank you all for joining us today.